This outbreak was one of the most serious E. coli outbreaks in recent history. Over 5,000 people were affected by this outbreak, and at the last count there were over 50 deaths.
The outbreak was E. coli, that's Escherichia coli, and this is a common gut bacterium which lives in all our guts and normally helps us digest food and so on. But in certain circumstances, E. coli can cause disease. And this was a particularly severe disease involved with HUS syndrome, which is hemolytic uremia syndrome, which causes can cause fatal kidney failure. So obviously this was of high concern to the international community. And in fact, the Beijing Genomics Institute in China decided to place their sequence as fast as possible out on the internet. And the whole idea was really to get an international community involved in the analysis, just to do it really quickly.
I became involved in the E. coli outbreak because we were fortunate enough to be in possession of a new sequencing instrument called an ion torrent. And during the outbreak, the Chinese Genomics Center, the BGI, released reads from the outbreak, which I was able to download and start analyzing while the outbreak was going on. So initially, there was about a day's lull after I posted an assembly of the genome sequence on my blog, and then after that it just went crazy. Within a few days, a number of people from four different continents had started analysing the data, and by 2 weeks there were over 50 pieces of independently produced analysis on the genome sequence posted on blogs and disseminated via Twitter.
There was a huge sense of urgency while everyone was really keen to put in their analysis, and people were working on it round the clock, and especially helped with people working on it in Australia as well as in Europe and slightly in America.
The use of crowdsourcing, where the aim is to get information out in a timely fashion using the internet, is really a very novel idea in science, where often the pressure is to get published papers. In this case, it was because there was an ongoing outbreak which was affecting thousands of people, and there was an absolute imperative to get that information into the public domain as quickly as possible, and that drove that analysis.
We became much more heartily involved with the downstream analysis from that. So the annotation, where we actually call what the genes are and attempt to place a function onto the genes, and the downstream analysis from that again, which is comparative genomics, where we compare different genomes.
Some of the early press releases had suggested that this was an entirely novel strain never seen before, but the genome sequence data confirmed that this was a variant of an existing type of strain which had acquired some virulence factors which were probably significant in the severity and the lethality of this outbreak.
The crowdsourcing really brought the first analysis in terms of what sort of genes were involved. I mean, particularly pinpointing this bacterial phage, which is a bacterial virus which carried the Shiga toxin. And the Shiga toxin is something you can really put your finger on and say this was causing the HUS, the hemolytic uremic syndrome, which could give rise to the fatal kidney failure.
The study of bacterial genomics shows us that bacteria are constantly engaged in sex and recombination with each other, exchanging genetic material, and under selection by humans, by things like antibiotics, we're encouraging the development of more resistant strains, and this strain was particularly antibiotic resistant. There was an interesting combination of collaboration and competition during the crowdsourcing, because people wanted to get their curiosity-driven analysis out there first, but of course there was also kudos for being the first to do it.
So it was great to be involved with kind of friends, almost like a family kind of thing, but there was also a touch of competition involved with who was going to get out various data first.
What we've learned from this crowdsourcing effort is that it can be done, and we're not limited by technological communications issues now. what we need to do is to try and harness the power of these types of technologies in routine surveillance of pathogens and enduring outbreaks. And this provides a model for how that could be done.